have you heard the old people are coming? And I bet you think it's those pesky baby boomers. But did you know that the millennial generation is the same size as the baby boomers? So let's talk about the causes of population aging. So to do this, I'm going to take you on a journey to our early history. When man first started out, we lived in small bands. We ate what we could find. The most common cause of death was a tooth infection. But then we figured out that we could collect these seeds, and we could take these animals and we could put them in cages. So we started domesticating these things. And then we had surpluses, and we could store this food for a later date. And as we stored this food, people were able to specialize, and they were able to do research and come up with tools like the plow. And this led to more innovation and specialization. And then we transitioned from tools to machinery that's run by steam and coal. Amazing innovations that paved the way for even more innovation. Plumbing, electricity, sanitation, these things began emerging in this time period. But then we move forward to another revolution, the digital revolution, when our machines shrank and they became transistors and microprocessors. Changed the way that individuals and organizations interact with each other and helped pave the way for some of the most amazing advancements of our human history. Advancements like sanitation, penicillin, vaccinations, milk pasteurization, hand washing, landfills, these things were not common 100 years ago. So let's talk about pre-industrialization and the mortality rates. A lot of people died, and a lot of people were born. But then the demographic transition began to occur, and the number of people who died declined, especially in the children. And then the fertility rates also began to decline until we got to a point where fertility and mortality were equal. So let's talk about the parents of baby boomers. The greatest generation. They came of age during the Great Depression. They fought in World War II. They didn't have more children than any other generation in history. So what changed? This is par for the course. Children died, and they died often. Polio, measles, diphtheria, pertussis, E. coli. In 1952, there were 1,000 cases of polio in the state. By 1963, there were zero. The polio vaccine was introduced. So the baby boom generation came of age when vaccinations were required for school. Pasteurization was widespread. Children stopped dying. The baby boom generation is the last generation of children born to large families. Human innovation, not the baby boom, are the reason that we have so many older adults. So why does the cause matter? Why does thinking of the boomers as the cause so important? Thinking of them as the cause creates short-sighted solutions. You don't think of the real cause of what is happening. Potentially, 1 in 5 employees and customers will be over the age of 65. And we live in a society that was built when the population was this. Peter Pan housing for people who will never grow old, stairs, split level, laundry in the basement, have communities that require a car to get around. But our society doesn't look like this anymore. This is what our society looks like. In 1900, the median age was 23. By 1970, it was 28. In 2010, it was 37. Half the population in 2010 was over the age of 37. Drastic change in 100 years. There are barriers to the environment that we live in. People with mobility limitations who may need assistive devices, could they come to these places? Could they come to our stores and use them? Loud music for people who have hearing impairments, also a barrier. But we live in the digital age, so we can't just think about our built environment. We need to consider our virtual environment. We live on tourism here. And our websites are the first way that people often interact with us. And the website on the top might be hard for someone to see, so they turn away and they go to this website. So we have some thoughts about aging in older adults that are counterproductive. Frail, sick, disabled, needy. Only 5% of adults over the age of 65 are living in nursing homes. Older adults are very active and very healthy. And I'd like to introduce you to a gentleman out of Hot Springs. His name is Lyle Sonnenshine. He participates in the senior games. He does very well. He's active, energetic. He has a lot that he can offer to our communities. So how can we capitalize on their knowledge and experience? So let's talk about what some businesses have done to think about population aging. BMW, they took one line, they made it older. They asked the people, what do you need? Wood floors, supportive shoes, magnifying glass, large screen monitors, 70 small changes costing around $50,000. Not only did they increase productivity, they reduced the defect rate to zero. And while that's not practical for all businesses, what scheduling options can we offer adults who would like to remain in the workforce? Part-time, flex scheduling, job sharing. These are ways that we can capitalize on the experience and knowledge that older adults have in this time when we have a shortage of employees. We stand poised at a pivotal moment. And while demography is not destiny, two things have to happen for this to change. A lot of people die, or a lot of people are born. So how can our communities respond to this demographic, unprecedented event in our human history?
I do.
Go for it.
How does the mortality versus birth rate compare today?
We have experienced lowest fertility rates since they've been reporting. We're around 66 per thousand between women aged 14 to 44 is what they count, and we're down to 66. At the height of the baby boom, we're around 115. I mean, it's a tremendous change. It's amazing, really, that it's happening. And a lot of people, I know a lot of people my age that are no children. You know, and that has serious repercussions for how we do business as communities and states. And it's happening worldwide. That's an important thing. It's not just happening in the states. It's even happening in third world countries. You know, the difference is in the states, it took 120 years for our population of adults over the age of 65 to go from 6 to 12. And some of the developing countries, that change is going to happen in like 30 years. It's happening worldwide.
Any projections as far as what that lower fertility rate, what the impacts are for a culture?
And here in South Dakota, they're projecting about 23% of the population is going to be over the age of 65. So you have that, and then you have the small concentration of youth. And there's a index of aging, and I've got the data. I should have written some of the numbers down. But there's index of aging, and what it does is it compares the number of adults over the age of 65 to the number of youth under the age of 15. And some areas in the state, it's incredible. Zero is more youth, 100 is equal. You go above 100, there's more adults. We've got some areas of the state that are around 300 already, right now. You know, so it's an incredible thing. So our workforce is going to be smaller, and adults, older adults are healthy and active. You know, they can still contribute, but we don't often think of them that way. We think that, you know, it's time to retire. You know, and there's so much, I mean, valuable, things that they can offer. Any more questions? Yes, ma'am.
So do you work in with the older populations? Is that how you get this knowledge or this passion that you have for this subject?
Passion's me.
Sure.
And I work for South Dakota State University. I'm a gerontology field specialist. I'm tasked with knowing my stuff. I create curriculum and programs for the community to try to help people age in place. You know, it's possible, but it takes some knowledge and some ingenuity to make it happen, especially if you look at our housing stock. I hear over and over again, I can't find a single level house. You know, so I'm an educator by trade. That's what I do.
Can you talk a little bit about aging in place? Because I've heard that phrase. It's kind of a new phrase, you know.
It's definitely a buzzword in my profession. Aging in place means that the person ages wherever they are. So whether that is in their apartment or their house or even out on the ranch or the farm. Because because they want to age out there. That's some other challenges. But that basically means staying where you are for as long as you are able. There come some points where you're not able. Maybe you need extreme help. Then you may not be able. But for the most part, aging in place refers to staying in your home or community for as long as possible. Yes, ma'am.
Aren't there some kind of frightening projections regarding a diminishing tax base and an increasing need for services?
That is a real concern, because a lot of services for elders are, I'll start out with a question. Do you know who Medicaid primarily pays for? Who receives the largest portion of Medicare dollars? Any guesses? Older adults. It pays for nursing home care. Granted, there's a moratorium on the number of nursing home beds, and we're having that challenge of trying to move nursing beds over to this side of the state because we have a real need. That is a potential challenge that we may face. You know, if the tax base diminishes, I mean, you think taxes 18 to 64, there could be some real challenges. And that's why our communities need to come up with innovative ways to address these challenges. You know, most of caregiving is done at home. But what are we doing to help our caregivers who are providing care at home to their families? Care for the caregivers, yes ma'am.
Yeah.
You had a question.
Yeah, do you see a shift in career opportunities for people into geriatric fields with the changing population?
There's a definite demand. The challenge that I see and a lot of people in my profession see is the training options. Like, we need nurses. There is a huge shortage of nurses, and that's why the flex scheduling and the mommy tracks would be really beneficial to the nursing field. We don't have enough slots to train the nurses that we need. And that's happening all across the board. And then you look at job positions like CNAs. There's a high turnover rate in CNAs. And CNAs are, in my mind, one of the most important jobs and the most least appreciated.
This imbalance between youth and older people must be occurring in very rural areas in
yes,
our state. And so then that just further complicates allowing them to age at home. Who's going to help them?
And that's, PBS did a really recent show on aging in South Dakota. It was really great. I highly recommend watching it. It's available on their website. And one of the participants in the panel made that exact comment. People want to stay in rural South Dakota, but home health services, homemaking services, meal services, a lot of these are not available. Then you go to the medical care. Telemedicine is a new thing that they're trying to move out to rural communities, but still, you have to have the professionals who can do the work. So there's some real, that's the rural South Dakota has some unique challenges. And a lot of people come to Sioux Falls and Rapid City because they can get the care. Yes, ma'am.
Just one more. Isn't a question more or less a comment? I was an RN for 50 years. Finally retired in 93. But with all my experience, I am still working part-time at the hospital. Instead of on my feet, I do it on my seat because I do data processing. But it's experience that people look to you for. And when you say you're going to be there, you're going to be there, you know.
And that is one awesome thing. I'm glad you said that. Older workers are amazing because they're saying they're going to be there, they come. You don't have to worry about them like my young folks. They don't show up. But that's important in your skills and experience. And data processing is a very important thing that we need. So, and that's the importance of capitalizing on all of the human capital that we have, because there's a lot of it, you know.
Geriatrics and then set up the oncology unit, like regional.
Exciting.
A few years ago, so a lot of experience.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, thank you, Leacey. One other question, I'm sorry.
Just one more. You had mentioned about the millennials also being a large generation and the tax base. I'd be curious what your thoughts on what kind of the rise of long-term care insurance are and where you think that's going to go.
I think long-term care insurance is going to be essential. Most people in this room will need long-term care at some point. Whether it's 10 years of long-term care or a short period, long-term care insurance is going to be very important to investigate. You've got to read the fine print. Some of these policies only do a certain amount of time. So, yeah, it's important. I think our generation really needs to examine options for paying for our care as we age. And exercise, because exercise is important. That's preventative. All the research says. Okay, I'm done. Thank you.
Wow.